please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hello and welcome. You're watching us on Business Lunch. I'm Nisha Podar and with me is Manglam Malu. Manglam, good afternoon. It's a good day after 8 today. Markets near the high point of the day. In fact, Nifty 50 has made attempts of conquering the 10,700 level also in the trading session today. What has really changed in the last half an hour of trade is that from midcaps being the biggest outperformers in the market, now it's the bank Nifty and the entire NBFC and the banking stocks which are really taking the lead as far as gaining momentum and giving a fair bit of strength to the market is concerned. So nothing to complain about here, but two things that have really played out. Softening crude oil prices have really revved up as far as the OMCs are concerned. So all the oil marketing companies are doing well. The overall markets are doing well. But one pocket which is really clearly sulking today is the IT space, because rupee has strengthened with the prospects of crude really coming down, Mangla.
Absolutely. But the good part is that, you know, our markets are also outperforming the key Asian indices. The European markets are doing fairly well. So if you take a look at the Asian indices, the Korean markets, that one ended with a gain of close to around 0.6%. The Shanghai as well as the Nikkei were lower in trade today. The Taiwanese index as well. So majority of the Asian markets are ended in the green, but we outperformed all of them. And as we speak, the European markets, we're seeing some fair amount of opening out there. The CAC is sitting with a gain of 0.5%. The German index too sitting with a gain of close to 0.6%. What is interesting is the FTSE MIB Italian index, which was underperforming on Friday's trading session, has now recovered some of those losses, sitting with a gain of 1%.
That's an important development there. Let's also get some market opinion going. And Kenneth Andrade, who's a founder and CEO of Old Bridge Capital Management, says that the market will remain volatile until bond yields really settle in a range. However, he feels that a good time to build a portfolio it is indeed.
So this is the first time where you can actually sit back, take your time, build a portfolio and establish confidence or track your portfolios or the companies that you've invested in the past. So I think it's an easier period at this point in time for portfolio managers, and not so difficult as it has been in the last 2 years. Bond yields continue to move higher, which has been the case globally. There's been a pressure on earnings yields. And that's the volatility that's been set in place since December of last year. So my sense is, until there is very clear direction on how this how bond yields actually build up, I think markets will continue to remain volatile. So from the context of where we are right now, I think bond markets offer you as good an opportunity as equity is probably for this year and probably for the next year.
All right, that was Kenneth, a big market voice, but let's move on to a big voice coming in from the banking space as well. With the resolution of Bhushan Steel under IBC, it is the beginning of a new era for the banking sector. That's the word coming in from former SBI Chairman Arundhati Bhattacharya in an exclusive conversation with Lata Venkatesh.
Surely I do think that it's at long last sort of beginning to crystallize, and we have to understand that this is a new law. So, you know, it's going to be tested. Plus, you also must understand that these are valuable assets. So nobody is sort of going to give up without a fight. And however, you know, the good thing is that most of the cases where it has gone to the courts have been very prompt, and they have given very well-reasoned judgments. That's very important, because then the case laws are framed. And then, you know, subsequently, anybody comes with the same kind of issue, it's much easier to resolve. Even where investments are very low, credit growth is very low, still, if you look around, you'll see many sectors doing very, very well. So, you know, if you consider the commercial vehicle sector, if you consider aviation sector, if you consider the sheer number of tourist arrivals and the usage of the airports, you know, I was told the other day, Mumbai Airport is handling more than 980 flights on a daily basis. So, you know, if you look at all of these numbers, you can understand that there is a momentum in the country. And that is slowly now, you know, beginning to have its impact on our other numbers. So I think, you know, it's a good thing that has happened, and we'll hope for many more resolutions in the next few months.
Okay, but the big fear since I was a
reporter and a cub reporter in 93 when the DRT Act was passed, and a more seasoned reporter in 2003 when Sarfaesi was passed. Even now, there are 4,000 cases and only 2,000 are being heard in the 12 NCLTs. Is there a fear that this might get overwhelmed under the weight of cases?
See, there is no doubt about the fact that you need to create the kind of bandwidth that will enable these cases to be heard and heard quickly and resolved. So there is no doubt about that at all. And in fact, you know, I think I would say that it's the media's job to keep tracking this so that nobody forgets about it, that it doesn't sort of, you know, get onto the back burner and people start disregarding it as we have the delays in the regular courts.
Well and truly on, closer to the 10,700 mark for the Nifty, near 265 point rally for the Sensex. We're at the high point of the day for all the frontline indices, including the mid-cap index, which is now closing in on that 19,000 mark. A couple of stocks from the frontline space which have moved to the high point of the day, the likes of Coal India, that one should come up for you. That one's moved to the high point of the day. And L&T, that one too has moved to the high point of the day. Remember, the company posts its numbers today. So we'll keep an eye out on that space. But the space that has been buzzing on the downside and the one that has caused our markets to a flutter in today's trading session has been crude, the big story of the day. Manisha Gupta here with the details. Manisha, 75 for the Brent, 67 for NYMEX. Is it temporary or what's the view?
You know, Mangalam, what it said about crude prices, that it is a lot of politics, lot of sentiment, and then some fundamentals.
Okay.
And that's exactly what the crude oil prices are displaying in sense of price views right now. The last 3 days have seen 6% of decline coming for the crude oil prices on the news that you will have Saudi Arabia and Russia come out and provide additional 1 million barrels per day into the markets. Well, it's not done as of yet. And this will happen because there is some supply gaps being created by Venezuela and Iran, which actually produce 14% of the OPEC output as of now. So 1 million barrel doesn't really add up as of now because we are looking at more supply crunches coming in from the other countries. But it's being taken as a bit of a bearish view. And that is the reason you have seen that profit taking come in. $75 per barrel seems to be holding right now because the markets would want to watch out for the U.S. weekly inventory numbers, where we have seen them bearish come in the previous week. But if that is the cue, then you might see some more decline come in for the prices. Overall, the market view is that with the kind of strong global demand that we are looking at, the sector, of course, has been underinvested. And the markets also are looking at the geopolitical concerns, mainly from Middle East. So those factors will continue to play in. And the profit taking that the markets were looking for perhaps has already happened.
All right, we will keep an eye out on that, but let's also hear out what David Lennox of Fat Profits had to say on crude.
At this stage, we'll be very happy to keep that range of between 74 to 84. We're not at this point really ready to change our range. We do now have to wait and see if in fact OPEC and the Russians do follow through and do lift that ceiling production.
All right, take a look at Fortis Healthcare stock, and that one is up 1%. It has lost a little bit of the gains that it caught because of Munjal Burman's bid, which was accepted by the board. And now they have written a letter to the company saying that they are open to the company opening this particular process for another round of bidding. Now, this is mostly an affirmation of what is to happen. So it clearly states that this particular deal is not yet over and the best offer shall win. Remember that the shareholders were not very happy with this particular bid process. And now the erstwhile directors of the company have also been ousted from the company as well. So after that, new bidding process with higher bids coming in is the expectation of the shareholders. And that's why that stock is up in trades today. So this particular saga is not yet over. But we'll shift focus to the big earnings of the day. Then Larsen & Toubro, that's the one which will be in focus ahead of its Q4 numbers, and that stock is gaining momentum ahead of the results almost really expected from Larsen & Toubro today. Anisha.
Well, yes, that is what we're expecting, a steady quarter from L&T this time, both as far as revenue is concerned, also on the order inflow front. First, to run you through the numbers, we are looking at a revenue growth of around 13%. Margin is expected to expand by around 70 basis points to come in at 12.5%. profit optically would look flat year on year at that 3030 crore mark. But do remember last year there was a bit of exceptional as well as a tax element that really impacted the numbers. So this time around we expect it to moderate. Now to break down the numbers, we are looking at a revenue growth of 13% driven by the infrastructure segment. If a double digit growth comes in on that front, it will be taken very positively by the street. Other than that, we are working with an 8 to 10% growth on that front. Talking about the order inflows, yes, that have been quite steady as far as quarter one is concerned. To meet their guidance for FY18, they have to come out with an order inflow number of around 40,000 odd crores. They've already informed to the exchanges regarding 33,000 odd crores. So they should be able to meet their order inflow guidance for FY18 is what the street is betting on. Going forward, what will be really important is the management commentary, especially regarding the guidance for FY19, as well as the balance sheet components and the exit of non-core sectors. Because remember, now the focus of the analysts and the street has moved from P&L to the balance sheet of L&T for regarding the ROE as well as net working capital movement. Because remember, last year it had come to 19% level. It had deteriorated in the quarter gone by. So very important to watch out how the net working capital move for the company and what is the guidance for FY19. Back to you.
Fair point. Thanks a lot for that, Anisha. In fact, we're not done with earnings yet. Aurobindo Pharma from the pharmaceutical space will also be reporting its fourth quarter numbers today. Ekta, what are you expecting from Aurobindo Pharma?
Well, yes, Aurobindo is going to be coming out with numbers today, and that will be post-markets. Now, in terms of the numbers for Aurobindo, the street is quite is anticipating what would be around a 20% growth on a year-on-year basis, with the margins coming in at around 22% this quarter, with a profit growth as well. Now, simply because of the U.S. business, which should grow on a year-on-year basis because of drugs launched such as Renvela generic, which is for the kidney, and that should basically contribute on a year-on-year basis for Aurobindo. Though Q-on-Q, there could be some amount of pressure on the U.S. business simply because of reasons such as pricing pressure and higher amount of competition. Now, in terms of the commentary, that would be really important for Aurobindo this time, especially with regards to its injectables unit, Unit 4, and what might the status be there, be from that particular unit in terms of fresh launches, as well as what the outlook is with regards to maybe any sort of inorganic plans, as well as fundraising and their plans in terms of the US launches, considering the pricing pressure scenario that a lot of the companies are facing.
All right, awaiting Aurobindo Pharma as well as Larsen & Toubro in terms of numbers today. But Bank of Baroda, let's talk about the review as well. And that's at the high point of the day, gaining about 2.5% in trade. It posted an operationally weak quarter this time. And Lata Venkatesh caught up with P.S. Jayakumar, who's the MD and CEO of the company, for the detailed fine print and the succession plan of the bank going forward. Here's a slice of that exclusive conversation.
I think there's a bias in favor of the first quarter and the second quarter. After that, I think, because, you know, those who are in the boundary line are going to fall off early than later. So I think there'll be a bias towards the first two quarters, and thereafter it probably will slow down. Okay. See, one of the points that one has to note is while the slippages were high last quarter, and rather the last year and the year before, the recoveries were not quite to the mark. One is hoping that this NCLT will give us some momentum in terms of getting recoveries to a better stage than what it was before. So surprises, if any, on the negative side would also be made good by better recoveries compared to last.
And the markets are pretty much maintaining that status quo. 10,693 is where Nifty 50 is. So looking at pretty much at the high point of the day and looking at inching towards that 10,700 mark. As far as Bank Nifty is concerned, that is showing enough strength. And at the moment, I would say that some of the tech companies have shown a little bit of recovery in the last few minutes of trade, but nothing can be said at the moment because they had been the biggest draggers in the market. Persistent System actually fell to the lowest point of the day very sharply, and Heritz recovered a slight bit. So keep an eye out on that particular bit as well. But there's lots to talk about when it comes to Indian politics, and voting began today for by-elections in 10 assembly constituencies spread across 10 states in the country and 4 Lok Sabha seats. CNN News 18's Pallavi Ghosh joins us with all the details on that development. Hi, Pallavi.
Yes, it's very critical because, you know, I would focus on states like, for example, particularly Haryana, or like Uttar Pradesh, where that Kairana, that important bipole which takes place. And that also is going to be a test case as far as opposition unity is concerned. This time, the other opposition political parties have put up one candidate against the BJP's candidate. And we recently saw that bonhomie among opposition political parties at that oath of the Karnataka Chief Minister Kumaraswamy in Bengaluru. In that sense, it will be a test case where the opposition unity or Mahagathbandhan really does work. Already there are allegations of EVM malfunctioning which are being taken up by one of those opposition parties, that's the RLD and even the Congress party. So should the BJP lose over here, it of course would be embarrassing for the BJP, but that apart, it would also be a thumbs up as far as opposition unity is concerned. And therefore I would say Kairana bipole results are going to be a very, very good indicator about where this whole opposition, united opposition versus BJP is really going to be working. Apart from that, another important state is that of Bihar. Nitish Kumar versus the RJD. Tejaswi Yadav, as we know, Lalu Prasad Yadav's son, is now coming up as the next big leader over there, and he's positioning himself as anti-JDU, anti-BJP. So if Nitish Kumar, for him, is a battle of prestige, and this guy's got a substantial Muslim population, so does it mean his tying up with the BJP means his core traditional vote bank is moving away from him? It would again be very interesting. In Maharashtra, it's an ally versus ally. Shiv Sena has already snubbed the BJP by saying, we are not going to have an alliance with you in 2019 Lok Sabha elections. Shiv Sena pitted opposite the BJP in Palghar, where the bipoles are taking place. So all in all, bipole results are often dismissed as of no indicator, but so close in an election season, I think it's going to be extremely significant.
Absolutely. Thanks a lot for that. We will keep an eye out on the developments there and the results coming in from those bipole election. But let's move on to an exclusive then. Sources tell CNBC TV18 that Mahindra and Mahindra, they're planning a massive launch strategy. They will launch all the three scheduled launches in quick succession. A revamp of dealerships to regain the market share this festive season is also on the cards. Utkarsh is here with all the details. Over to you, Utkarsh.
This festive season will be a very important festive season for Mahindra and Mahindra to regain its lost market share, and very importantly, three important product launches slated this year. What we are picking up from our sources is that M&M is planning to launch all these three products in quick succession. That is from September to November, all these three products, which are the U321, S201, and the G4 Exton will be launched. Also, what we are picking up is that the company, before the launch, will be making changes in the way their showrooms are. You can call it the modernization of showrooms, you can call it the redesigning of showrooms. But what will be the major changes? What we are picking up is that Mahindra wants to build a non-car showroom. So a lot of themes based on SUVs is what you will see in these showrooms. In fact, these showrooms will be called the world of SUVs. Also, what we are picking up is that a lot of digitization will also be included in this showroom. So you can see large LED screens, you can see a lot of tablets for 360 degree views being implemented. Also we are picking up is that the concept of virtual showroom will be tested by M&M in the next few months. It will be a pilot project across a few cities, but that will also take place. Now, why is it that the company is really going ahead and launching all three products in succession? Because that is not something which happens in a normal course. Companies really want to spread out their launches, majorly to make sure that they're able to focus on one launch at a point of time. But what we're picking up from our sources is that company wants to regain its dominant position in the SUV market and the image of an SUV leader by launching all these three products back to back in a bang. Also, very importantly, 2019 will be an important year for the SUV market, given that Tata's, Maruti, Kia, SAIC MG will be launching its new SUVs. Before the starting of 2019, M&M really wants to come into the SUV market and regain its brand as an SUV leader with a bang, and is banking heavily on this whole plan.